Okay, so welcome everybody. So we already have 54 participants, that's great. Today Marielle Sulika is giving a talk, a presentation on using fault trees for predictive maintenance. And some general information, we have quite some program for the next weeks. I will put it on the website probably today. And from now on, I will also include the Zoom links on the website, so it's a bit easier to access the information that you need. Yeah, Maria, please go ahead.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to give a talk today on predictive maintenance via fault trees and model checking. And okay, this is the first problem. How do I navigate to the? Yeah. And let's first briefly say about something about myself. I studied mathematics and computer science at the Radboud University in Nijmegen. I also did my PhD there, and then I moved as a postdoc to California. Wonderful time. And in 2004, I took up a position in Twente, where I'm now a professor of risk management for high-tech systems. And but I'm also one day a week a professor at the Radboud University, so going back to the start. And of course, I'm coordinating the Primavera project, but I'm also very proud that I have an ERC consolidator grant on the integration of safety and security aspects. So today, I had the following outline in mind. I will tell you how we can combine data-driven and model-driven prognostics through fault tree analysis. I tell you what fault tree analysis is, how that all relates to data and maintenance, and of course end up with some conclusions. And I decided to copy the Van Houten model and have some room for discussions. And depending on the amount of discussions, I may or may not arrive at the end of my slides. But let's get started. So of course I don't have to introduce predictive maintenance to you, but nevertheless, and I think there's some remarks about that. One that is that there was an interesting report by McKinsey, and McKinsey claims that predictive maintenance is the most promising IoT, Internet of Things application. And McKinsey foresees a cost savings by using predictive maintenance of $63 billion a year, as well as a 50% reduction in downtime. Of course, that sounds super promising. At the same time, we have another report, this time by PricewaterhouseCoopers, that acknowledged that predictive maintenance is very promising, but at the same time, they say it's actually realizing the benefits of predictive maintenance is not easy because a lot of technology is not realized. It's not leveraged. Everybody is in their own silo. They are smart, small-scale solutions, but it's not a holistic approach that tells companies where to start, how to implement it, which technologies to use, etc. And of course, those are the ambitious goals of Primavera. And on the right, you see the current level of predictive maintenance maturity, and actually real predictive maintenance starts only at level three, where only 20% of the companies is in that level. So in the Primavera project, we use the predictive maintenance workflow. So we cover the whole predictive maintenance workflow, starting with data acquisition. What kind of sensor networks do you want? What kind of sensor technology works for your maintenance needs? Then we do data processing and diagnosis. Which data do we need to select? How do we clean data? A lot of data is dirty, of course. How do we interpret data to obtain useful information? And based on that information, we can do prognostics and we can predict all kinds of interesting stuff like the remaining useful lifetimes, etc. And today is about prognostics. Well, if you know when your system will fail is one thing, but another completely different thing is how to use that information in your maintenance planning. Because in the end, you want to optimize your maintenance strategy. And that is the fourth step in the predictive maintenance workflow, where we do asset management and fleet management. And of course, there's very important, we want to develop solutions that work for people and that work for organizations. So that's why human factors and organizational factors are also an integral part of this project. So today is about prognostics. So what is prognostics? Prognostics means that you predict the time at which a system or component fails, and it will no longer perform its intended functions. There's a couple of metrics or key performance indicators you can use for this prognostics. An important one is the remaining useful lifetime. What's the expected time that the system will still function? But also there's the system availability. What is the average uptime of your system? You want an uptime of 99% on average. What is the system reliability? So the probability that your system fails before a given mission time. So what's the probability that the dikes overflow in the next year? And of course, also we're interested in the expected cost of the failures and the maintenance strategy. And all of those things we want to predict, to prognose. There are two main methods if you want to do system prognostics. You can do it model-driven or you can do it data-driven. And model-driven means you predict your KPIs from a model. And this can, whereas data-driven prognostics means that you predict your KPIs from a data set. Well, both have their pros and their cons. If you want to build a model, you need a detailed domain expertise. You need to know exactly under which conditions your system or component operates. Creating a model it takes time. It's manual. However, the good thing is that such models provide a lot of insight in why your system fails. It's a white box method. It's explainable. Data-driven methods, on the other hand, well, you get a bunch of data and you let modern AI techniques predict your next failure. It's fast. You don't need as much domain knowledge, but you do need a large data set and a large data set of high quality. And that's often a problem because data we collect contains all kinds of failures and irregularities. Also, the main disadvantage of data-driven methods is that they're not explainable. So they tell you why a component fails, but they don't tell you why it fails or degrades. And many of those techniques are geared towards finding correlation and not necessarily causation, even though these days a lot of research is done on that. For instance, Tom Heskes, who is also part of the project, has as main topic finding causal models for data analytics. So that is why the smart industry roadmaps believe that big advantages can be taken by combining both methods. They say the challenge is to reconcile the perspective of the domain experts with the failure mode analyses with the perspectives of data analysts with the correlation between environmental and internal factors and degradation behavior. And well, that's exactly what we also aim at in the Primavera project. And because for model-driven prognostics, there are a few models available. There are physical models, and Tito Tinka is working and typically has a lot of expertise in this field, is working on that. There's finite element models, differential equations, and there's also fault trees, and today's topic. Those models are quite old, often from the 50s. And it's also important to point out that whereas physical models are often geared at component level, fault trees are more at system level, saying how failures propagate from components through the system. Of course, data analytic models, data-driven prognostics, have numerous methods as well. You probably have heard of them, neural networks, Bayesian networks, etc. And what some people find surprising, they're also from the 50s. Maybe not their application in maintenance, but a lot of neural networks, they were invented in the 50s as well. So we want to combine both methods. So how do we do that? Well, actually, there's two ways in which you could combine these things. One way is you can use models to improve your data analytics. And what you can, for instance, do is you can do accelerated learning. You pre-configure your data-driven model pre-configure your data-driven methods via models. It says data on the slide. That's a mistake. Then what you can also do is data augmentation. So as I said, data-driven models need a lot of data. If you have not that much data or you're missing certain configurations, you can generate additional data points from your model. You have to do that carefully, but that can be done. Then there's also data validation. So you use your model to assess if a data set is correct, if a data element makes sense, conforms to your model, or whether it is corrupted. Similarly, data cleaning, you correct or you remove data points that do not conform to your model. And this can be a full model, or you can also do a simpler, easier check to already filter out data that for sure do not make sense. And all these kind of techniques, this is really an area of very active research, a lot of work in progress. Now we can also do the converse. We can use data to help model-based approaches. And one of the main, and I would say one of the basic techniques is data fitting. How you fit your model parameters based on data you've collected during the operation of your system. How you can, for instance, know the exact load, the exact operational conditions from your data set, and then feed those into your model. What you can also do is learn optimal parameters. So what is the optimal system load, or what is the optimal maintenance interval at which your system works best, or at which maintenance is most cost effective. More recent research is on learning the model itself, or learning missing elements in your model or missing parameters. And then you construct the model based on data. And again, novel research, very active and a work in progress. So this is my first point for discussion. What do people use in practice? Do you prefer a model-driven technique, data-driven technique, have for prognostics, or a combination? Is there any opinions?
Yeah, do you want us to chat or to do it verbally?
Maybe verbally.
Yes. Well, I think it depends if you have, if it's on components or structures that you have a good knowledge on, and you have sufficient knowledge to build models, and there's then often also tools for efficiently building models, then probably a model would be the preference. But if you don't have that, or if it's too difficult, then probably you start with data. So I think it depends upon the situation, also the goal that you have. Well, here is predictive maintenance. So let's say a lot on me. I think that's how I would look at it.
I think that they often should go hand in hand, that you may have a partial model of something you know well, or general structure, and then use data to augment the model to the more refined view of the system.
And how about At Waterschap de Dommel, do you use both? Do you use models? Do you?
Well, let's say for predictive maintenance, we do not really use models at the point of time. But for, let's say, for the wastewater treatment, we use mathematical models. There's a, let's say, worldwide consensus on, well, I would not say they're really wide, but they're mechanistic. There's some physical parts in it, like the flows and etc. and the chemical components. But there are also some black things in it, or gray, like the growth speed of the bacteria or biomass, which is thousands of species, but that's lumped into just one single or a few components. So it's something in between. But there's really some mechanistics in it which is easier in prediction, especially.
Mm-hmm.
So we use that, but for maintenance at this point of time, it's more data-driven, I would say, and also rather basic, really basic. So that's why we are in here in Primavera to learn.
Excellent. Other people?
So based on the previous speaker, a combination often is more powerful because some of the signals you're measuring can be inputted in a model, and a number of the signals will never be able to be modeled, or for which you don't have a model. And if you have a combination, then some of the signals can be treated like a black box or more data-driven, and the other signals for which you have that model.
What kind of combination do you then use?
Well, for instance, over here at NLARHE, we look a lot of in fatigue. Mm-hmm. Is the real failure mechanism. So some of the data can be used in the fatigue analysis, but some of the data cannot be used in the fatigue analysis. And then for that, you probably want to have, or we use a data-driven kind of model, but if you can combine both, probably you can use some of the information you get out of the model in the data-driven part as well. Eh? So, yeah.
Yeah. But
we
if
don't
I,
have this combination at NLR working at the moment.
Okay, eh? Okay. So you have sometimes you use model driven, sometimes you use data driven, but you don't yet combine them.
Exactly. No.
Okay.
No. So it would be nice if within this project we can somewhere find a combination.
Yeah.
And Marielle, I would like to add the physical models, so a physical test center will also give you additional information, certainly to improve your training set for machine learning. The machine learning algorithm has to be able to actually recognize data, so it needs a lot of labeled data which you can generate by a physical test setup. Necessary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a kind of data augmentation, but then you don't use a model, but you use physics for that.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. I am a physicist, so I'm used to actually doing the experiments.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Sounds good. Let's
Can I
move
add
on.
To that?
Okay.
So this is Hans Onfle from ASML. So I think I agree with John just mentioned. Because the problem with data-driven models is that you need the data. And if you have very complex, large systems, then the amount of data, so the number of, because if you want to use neural networks, you also need many instances of events to train the system.
Mm-hmm.
I think we always have to go for a combination of knowledge, or focus on knowledge, or use methods that can also work on very small sets of samples, because we will never be able to collect the sample size that you need to train prediction just on data.
Yeah.
So I don't believe actually that that is ever going to work, except for trivia as coffee machines and so.
Mm-hmm. And then, and then you make models, or do you also use the models to generate additional data?
Well, we do for some other machine learning. We also actually use models to generate data and then retrain on smaller sets of real data.
Mm-hmm.
So we use models and then real data. But for the diagnostics, we are struggling there. So, so the half of the most almost all errors and the total downtime is from a huge number of very rare events. So for those events, it's really extremely difficult to collect enough data, real data, to build a prediction on neural networks. So you need something that is smarter than just a neural network. That's what I see. And we have had several attempts and also all kinds of huge consultancy firms that say, oh, give us the data, we will predict everything, and they end up the crap.
Yeah, definitely.
I would like to downplay the power of neural networks in this context.
Sure. Yep.
Not that I'm against neural networks, by the way. They're fun. But,
yes.
Yep.
One statement from the neural network side, which is my background actually. But I agree with most speakers before here. It's a combination of everything, and it depends a lot on what you have available. Yeah, if you don't have expert knowledge available, then the data-driven side is most. But that's actually still a model with the difference that it's an implicit model.
That's true. Yeah.
So you could use that and try to basically open that black box to make it an explicit model, which is basically translating the neural network into an explicit model.
Yeah.
Although that is a very challenging step.
Yeah, I fully agree with you. And I'm actually not so precise with terminology here, but what I mean with a model is really, it's not, let's say, a neural network, but a mathematical explicit model that you can understand.
Model, yes.
Yeah.
But they are basically translatable into each other.
Yeah. So let's move on to the next topic, fault trees. What are they and what can we do with them? Well, fault trees are a very important method in a very important tool in reliability engineering, and it's a graphical model that tells you how systems fail. So it contains the failure modes and also the failure mechanisms that indicate how component failures lead to system failures. And you can do two types of analyses with them. You can do qualitative analysis, pinpointing root causes and critical parts, and then quantitative analysis. And here you can do all the metrics and the key performance indicators. A few common metrics are the system reliability. So what is the probability that your system has no failures during a given mission time? The availability, what's the average percentage of time that your system is up? There's mean time to failure, mean time between failures. This can also be done in the presence of maintenance intervals. And there's lots of industrial software tools available that support fault tree analysis. There's a lot of companies that work with fault trees. I've listed here just a couple of them. But let's look at an example. This is my favorite example. Suppose we're still allowed to travel and you want to go on a road trip. So, and then the question is, when does your road trip fail? Well, as a preventive measure, you've taken your phone. So your system fails, your road trip fails, if both your phone fails and your car fails. So this is an AND gate. For your phone, there's of course many, many reasons why your phone can fail. I've listed two of them here. So suppose that your phone fails because either there's no connection or there's no power. And power, you can, it can be either that your battery is empty or, your power fails if both your phone battery is empty and the engine of your car has a failure. Because if your battery is dead, but you have the engine of your car, you can power up your phone with your battery. Now for your car, cars can also fail for many reasons. I've listed two here. Either your engine fails or you have a problem with your tires. And now for your tires, typically, especially older cars, they have a measure, preventive measure, namely they have four primary tires and a spare tire in your trunk. And so your tire system fails if two out of those five tires fail. So if the first tire fails, you have your spare tire, but then if yet another tire fails, your tire system fails. So, and In terms of quantitative analysis, there are cut sets. Those are sets of basic events of leaves of the trees that make the tree fail. And cut sets, they are important because they indicate vulnerabilities. So if you have very small cut sets, meaning that you only need a few failures for your system to fail, this indicates a vulnerability, especially if the probabilities on failures are high, or if the elements are in your cut set are amenable to common cause failures. But at the same time, you can also do quantitative analysis, and there you predict the unreliability or the failure probability. And what people do there, they assign probabilities to the basic events, so to the leaves of your tree. So suppose that your connection fails with probability P1, your battery with probability P2, etc. Suppose you consider a year, what's the probability that your connection fails in that year? So you assign probabilities, frequencies to all your basic events, and then what is the question? What is now, given all my preventive measures, the probability that I strand in my road trip? Well, in this case, it's this reasonably complex expression. But again, there's software that can do those computations for you. And then you can, for instance, figure out if your system meets the reliability requirements. What is more common, though, is to consider failure behavior over time. So what you do then is you assign continuous probabilities. So how does my probability evolve over time? You can, for instance, do rates of exponential distribution, and then you can figure out what is the probability of my system to fail over time. And then if you see a sharp increase, then you know now it's time to do maintenance. What we have done in my team, we have augmented fault tree analysis with degradation behavior. So rather than just having one, saying your component has failed or is operational, we do we have degradation phases. So you start with your system in a perfect condition that's green, and over time it degrades, and it degrades until you end up in a red state where your system has failed. And what you can also do, those exponential and degradation happens according to an exponential probability distribution. And then now with COVID, we all know what exponential behavior is. And here I use a parameter lambda. That means that the average time that it takes to move from one phase to the other is 1/λ. So in the total time you need to degrade completely, end up in the red state, is then 4 times lambda, because you need to take 4 steps. What you can also do is that if you have a repair, you move back to the perfect state. And again, if you now with those new degradation models, you can again compute the reliability, the availability over time with those fault tree computation methods. And again, standard fitting techniques can learn those distribution models from data. This is a so-called Erlang distribution, and it is not so surprising because you know the average. In your data set, you can look at the average time it takes for your system to fail. That is then 4/λ. And you can look at the variance to see how many phases you need. Do you need 4 degradation phases? And the more degradation phases you have, the less variance you have in your distribution. So that is how you use data analytics. And now with such maintenance models, you can also look at optimal maintenance strategies. So you can look at first come, first serve maintenance. You can look at periodic inspections. You can look at clustered, by clustering maintenance strategies. And for all of those techniques, you can compute the reliability, availability, and the cost. Of course, fault trees are not the only models that tell you about failure modes and system risks. Maybe some of you have used FMEA, failure mode effect analysis, or FMEA-CAS, failure mode effect and criticality analysis. There's reliability block diagrams that work quite similar to fault trees, but their layout is a bit different. There is bow ties that have a fault tree on the left and then a consequence tree on the right. There are fish diagrams, etc. And in my opinion, those models really help to be more systematic about risk and about countermeasures. And you want to select the best countermeasures, and by systematically identifying your failure modes, it can really help to make better decisions. Of course, all models have pros and cons, and so the idea is to choose the best approach for the situation. And here, this is a graph from Rijkswaterstaat that is a kind of decision diagram that tells you in which circumstances you should do what type of analysis. It's unfortunately in Dutch, but you have to answer a few questions about your project, and whether the architecture is known, and whether there's quantitative requirements, and then they advise whether to use FMEA-CAS, FTA, which is fault tree analysis, RBD, reliability block diagrams. This is maybe the most important slide of my talk. It's a quote from the American statistician G.E.P. Box, and he says, "All models are wrong, but some are useful." And I think that fault tree models are definitely wrong, but also definitely useful. This is an example. This is a fault tree that a student of mine made for Arcadis on why rail fails. And this is the basic model. This is the total model. But what was very nice, so the reason why Arcadis liked this is that finally they had all failure modes and mechanisms in one model. Because it used to be the case that one department knew everything about welds and their failures, and the other department knew everything about system loads and how that would affect rail quality. And now they had one big overview, and that was why they were happy. So fault trees, you can, of course, as I said, also use them for maintenance optimization. If you buy more expensive components, you can look what is the effect on the reliabilities. You can look which failures occur most often, what could be maintenance strategies per failure type, and you can optimize costs. Also correlations between failures and environmental factors. And of course, you could argue, well, why do I need fault trees if I can't just obtain all those this information from data? Well, not always, because not everything may appear in your data, because if you don't know that you should measure something or that some events are relevant, they are not in your data. And that is why fault trees, by systematically refining system failures into smaller failures, can help for that. Anyways, again, some discussion time. My question is, do you use models in your company? Stefan said, yes, we do for hydraulics. If yes, which ones? And if no, what's the reason for that?
Hi, Marielle. This is Johan van de Boogaard.
Hi.
As you know, we use almost all models, FTAs, FMEAs, reliability block diagrams, basically all. So yes, we use them. And but I was wondering, I saw your slides and I saw that more or less you make your fault tree time dependent by defining different levels of lambda. That's correct.
Yeah.
And basically, oh, that's my assumption. You didn't explain, but my assumption is that behind that assumption of changing lambdas is degradation, physical degradation of the components itself. And then I'm a bit struggling. For me, let me try to explain how I see this. Let's assume you have a tire of a car. It degrades over time, because you drive and your profile becomes thinner, and in the end, your probability of failure gets higher every time, over time or over kilometers. Can be more failure mechanisms, and you translate that to time-dependent lambdas. Is that correct? Do I understand that correctly, or?
Well, the lambdas, the lambdas are not time-dependent themselves, so it's not like a Weibull distribution. But I have different degradation phases, and so, the system can be perfect, good, so-so, almost failed and failed. And between those, to move from one phase to another, that takes time. And the question is, what is the, that takes time. That time is not a one fixed value, because it's not always that exactly after 1 year your tire fails, or exactly after 1 year your tire moves from a perfect condition to a not so good condition. That can sometimes be half a year, sometimes be 1 year and a half. So that is a stochastic model. But to move from one degradation phase to the other, there we use still exponential, so still memoryless distributions.
But how do you decide on them then, if there's no physical degradation models under it?
Of course, ideally you have a physical degradation models that gives you those lambdas, or you learn from data.
Yeah, that doesn't really matter. But you have a view on how your component degrades. Try to translate that to a sort of a quality over time, a lambda, and you calculate in different phases. I do understand that, because fault trees are time independent in that sense, and you kind of make it time dependent by incremental increases.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Yeah, I was just wondering about the link between the physics, the components itself, and lambda. The tire, that example, of course, when you drive more and your profile becomes lesser, the probability that it fails will become higher. So your lambda will be higher.
Yeah, and I think two remarks are in place. Now, first of all, what we really want to do, and that's also ongoing work, is that we want to make those lambdas dependent on the operational conditions. So that we really add that if you drive more, your lambda becomes higher, and if you drive less, your lambda becomes lower. And and then load, then load will affect many, many parameters. So if you drive more, all tires will suddenly wear out more, except for your spare tire, not when it's sitting in your trunk, but when it. So that's my,
It's interesting. Thank you.
Let's move on. Where are we here? Let's move on. Yeah, now fault trees, data, and maintenance. So one of the things is, so we have our fault tree, we have all the failure data, we have the failure probabilities. How do we then compute all those metrics? This is a bit technical, but what we do underwater is we translate the fault tree into a stochastic model, and then with stochastic techniques, with standard stochastic techniques, we analyze those we compute the reliability. We do use Markov chains, and a particularity is that we make small fault tree is a large model, which we make a small stochastic model per fault tree component, so per gate, per per basic event, and then we make that into a large model, and then we do the analysis. And we have two methods for doing analysis, two classical stochastic methods. So we either do stochastic computations or we do Monte Carlo simulations. And for Monte Carlo simulations, we've also done work on rare event simulation, because if you can imagine that failures are rare and things don't fail every day. And that means if you do Monte Carlo simulation, you need a gigantic number of simulations to observe the event of interest and to obtain at results that are statistically significant. And that is why we use rare event simulation. With a small example here. So with rare event simulation, you can do the same simulations. You can do the same simulations with fewer samples. And the example is, suppose you have a coin and the probability on heads is 1/100 and the probability on tail is 99/100. Now, if you want to estimate the probability on heads, you need you need at least 1,000 samples. But then what we do is we artificially increase the probabilities that we like, and we decrease the probabilities that we don't like, but we account for that in the end result. So what we can do here is, rather than having a probability on heads of 1%, we say, no, the probability on heads is 10%, and the probability on tails is not 99%, no, it's 90%, but now we have to compensate that in the end result, and we do that by, rather than counting every occurrence of head as 1, we account every occurrence of heads at 1/10. And then you can show that this, you get exactly the same mean number of heads, because you count every head only with 1/10, but the variance is much lower, so you need much fewer simulations. And this worked quite well. And let me show this, because those are the results. Where should I look? The idea is we needed, the analysis was much faster, we needed fewer samples, and our confidence intervals were much, much narrower. And you can see that in those graphs here. In the table, you see that the confidence intervals are much lower for FTRS, rare event simulation. And also, we could have results where both exact analysis and standard Monte Carlo, and that's the MC column, standard MC column, simulation, standard Monte Carlo did not yield any results, but our method yielded results in all those, in all cases. So that is so much for analysis. Now, what about learning? What we have done here is that normally what you do is, you have a fault tree and you predict KPIs. You predict the number of failures, you predict the availability, you predict the reliability. But now what we wanted to do is we wanted to do the converse. We had failure data and we wanted to learn the fault tree model itself. So we have a large data set, and we know for every basic event, ABC, whether or not the fault tree failed. And failed is indicated by T, by top, for top. So for instance, if A and B and C are all 0, so they are all operational, then my system is operational because T is zero. If A is zero, has not failed, but B has failed, C has not failed, then the top is one. And we also do a count saying how often we observed that specific configuration. Now, based on this information, I want to automatically infer a fault tree that matches my data set. And that we did with genetic algorithms. This is also a very classical type of data analytics methods. It's again from the 50s, and it's inspired by biological evolution. So what we do here is we start with a population of guessed solutions, and then we iterate just like in biology. So we start by generating new species, both through modification and combination. We select the best solutions, and best means those that fit the data best. And you iterate this process until you're fed up. For instance, until you have reached a certain number of iterations, or until you have had a certain fit. And how genetic algorithms have been applied to numerous applications. But we wanted to do it for fault trees. So how does that work? So we start with just a few basic fault trees. That can just be only one basic event. And then what we can do is we can modify that fault tree with some procedures. We can also combine it says indeed, and this is a small mistake on the slide, genetic algorithm, not generic. So we modify one fault tree based on some procedures, and we can, for instance, change gates or do other things. We can also combine two fault trees for crossover to arrive at the new fault trees, etc. And then we check in step two, we check whether indeed we select those fault trees that we like best. And like best, I mean that fit with the data best, so that the number of predicted failures is the largest. And what we how do we modify fault trees? We either change a gate, so we can change an OR gate into an AND gate, we can change an AND gate into an OR gate, or we can swap branches. If we have two fault trees, we just swap their branches and then arrive at two novel fault trees. And we have a couple of other modifications techniques as well. And if we swap all this, so if we just randomly apply those ways of modifying fault trees, then we, for each novel fault trees we get, we check again, does it fit our data? How many records in our data are predicted correctly, and how many records in our data were not predicted correctly? And that gives us a fitness score, and we keep only those fault trees in our set with the highest fitness score. And then with a new population, we start all over again. We modify again, change AND gates into OR gates, swap branches, and do a couple of other operations. And every time we randomly select what we do until we have until we have reached a certain fitness. And then we learn those fault trees. Here you can see the result. In the first result, in the first graph, you see how many the accuracy over the number of BEs. It is true that if you learn few basic events, so only 6 or 7, the accuracy is higher than when you learn more BEs. And so the dotted orange line is just the individual that has won, that is the best fit. Also, in the right graph, you see what kind of operations were successful. And then you see the red line, that is where you create new BEs, that is a very successful operation and good operation. And in this way, so this is a rather standard method of learning fault trees. It's quite intuitive. It also gives fault trees with reasonable accuracy. However, it has also disadvantages because the fault trees that you obtain are not interpretable. And one of the advantages of fault trees is that they are interpretable. Also, since the algorithm itself is stochastic, you can get a different fault tree for every time you run the algorithm. So, what we've also applied this in fault trees that have holds. So we started already with a fault tree that we thought this is a reasonable fault tree, but we are just not sure about those gates and about those BEs. And then we try to improve on that fault trees. And you can also use similar techniques for learning physical models, for learning expressions. And I think that's good. That can be interesting as well. Finally, we have a website. We have a large collection of fault trees. We grow fault trees. So we have a website where we have collected many examples of fault trees that we found in the literature. We have also recorded all the results. So there are many articles with new methods for fault trees. So we collected the fault tree as a picture. You can see that on the right, where here. And people can submit their own fault tree. So if you have good fault tree models, you can also help us with improving this benchmarks. And I think I arrive at the end of my talk. So I hope that by now you know that fault trees are a widely applied methods. They help in decision making, for instance, figuring out which system parts are most vulnerable and which maintenance strategy is most appropriate. Then about fault trees and data, what we can do is we can compute various metrics from data. We can fit failure rates also based on data, or we can learn the learn fault trees from data. And now I want to go back to the very beginning where I said, well, you have model-driven and data-driven prognostics, and there's two ways in which we can combine them, namely models to data and data to model. So today I've talked about three of those methods, namely data augmentation, where you generate extra data from a model, fitting model parameters with degradation phases, or you can learn the model itself. And maybe learning a whole model, a whole fault tree model from scratch is not so relevant, but I do believe that if you have missing parts in your fault trees, then you can construct the missing parts in your fault trees and parts in your fault tree where you're not certain about or where the system has changed. Those you can learn by data. And well, that concludes my talk, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Yes. Interesting talk, Marielle. I have a question. On the failure modes, or the how are you sure you have all the failure modes? In this example that you have for the that you showed with mm-hmm. all the railway failures, mm-hmm. if you miss a few, your model is not complete. So how do you know that you cover the whole space of possible failures? Is there a check or something, or is it just application field knowledge?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Indeed, it is a lot of application field knowledge. Of course, again, you can look at data, because if you first of all, no, I fully agree. So this is not easy. There is no easy answer, and that is why GPBox has this quote: "All models are wrong, but some are useful." There is a few things that you can do, however. You can monitor your system, and if you observe failures that were not in your model, you can augment your model. Mm-hmm. You can also look at, for instance, cut sets and see if the cut sets you find are reasonable. And but in that sense, fault trees are not a panacea, but personally, I think that with fault tree analysis, because you're very systematic, you start,
yes.
Stop, and you refine, you get at least more failure modes than without.
It's not only for fault trees, of course. With EMEA, it's the same thing, of course, and block diagrams or whatever. So it's a more general question.
Yeah.
And things you don't know, of course. So let's say in aviation industry, for example, only when the first crash occurred with metal fatigueness, we knew that was a failure mechanism.
Yeah.
And so with the Challenger, for example, you only know things when they first go wrong for the first time.
The current pandemic is a very good example of that as well. Nobody expected the real severity of this. And also, this is what I also tell to my students: if you do a risk analysis or a safety case, please combine two methods. Please combine a very systematic method via fault tree analysis or whatever your favorite method is, but also always think out of the box. Mm-hmm. And I think that's
I use common sense.
Exactly.
Thanks. Interesting.
I have a more technical question, Marielle. This is Bob Huisman.
Mm-hmm.
If you, for technical reasons, want to make more discrete levels, because you're making your state in discrete levels, and for technical reasons, you can want to introduce more states, for example, to model dependencies between components.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
At the same time, by doing so, you're changing the statistical behavior of that component by introducing, actually you're getting a sum of more exponential distributions.
Mm-hmm.
Little by little, your lifetime moves from exponential to a normal distribution. So what you change due to technical reasons has impact on the statistical behavior of the model.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
Yeah, that's a good observation, very mathematical. It's true. I mean, so the reason why we use exponentials is because we're a bit lazy, because they are mathematically easy. But of course, the best thing is to have degradation phases and not necessarily exponential distributions, and really try to fit fit your distributions and use those levels maybe in your output rather than in your input model. Maybe this is not very clear. Let's say your input models, your statistical input models, should be as accurate as possible, and you shouldn't. And you're right that makes makes changes in the stochastics. By every degradation phase you introduce, you make the model more deterministic and it has less variance. And if your real system has a lot of variance, that should also be in your model.
And I think...
Maybe I have a better answer.
Okay.
The better answer is that what I showed you is linear, is Erlang distributions. But if you use non-Erlangs, if you have models with branching, then you can actually obtain, you can fit better to your data. Let's discuss this in a it's a quite technical argument. It's called so-called acyclic phase type distributions, and they, with acyclic phase type distributions, and this is very technical, you can approximate any other distributions you like.
Now, I think the important message is that mechanical engineers who make the model or modify the model should be aware that it has impact on the statistics, and if we are aware of that, we can take measures.
Sure. Yeah, and my dream is actually, and this is also an answer to Johan van der Boogaard's question earlier, my dream is that in the leaves of the fall tree, we click those mechanical models, and then both the mechanical engineers are and the reliability engineers are all happy because they can work with their own models.
Thank you.
I have one more technical question. You describe this rare event simulation where you increase the probabilities to have fewer computational effort. And this then afterwards you compensate for that. That can be done straightforwardly, you told.
Mm-hmm.
But is that due to the fact that's due to this failure description that you use so that it's linear? Because
no.
If it's nonlinear, can that also be done? So it's more like the proof of how can you do this. Is there a proof for that?
Yeah, there is a proof for that. Okay. And yes, so you can do this with also with other probabilities. Maybe the method becomes a bit more complex. Yeah, and the question is to find the right compensation. If you increase the probability by 10%, you want to decrease the outcome also by 10%.
That can only if it's somewhere it's linear. I can imagine that if there's a non-linearity involved, that it's not that straightforward, and that you have to compensate for the non-linearities in your model.
What is integrate? What is non-linear in what?
Well, if the in fact, you have a kind of mapping from every model is a kind of mapping from input to output.
Mm-hmm.
And if in this model you have non-linearities, this mapping may change if you. So I'm just wondering how straightforward this is.
Yes. Okay. So for this rare event simulation, what we usually do is we consider fixed models in the sense that they don't consume any input anymore. So everything is driven stochastically.
Maybe that's the reason. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, if there's no questions anymore, let's move back to Nils.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask if there are more questions.
Well, we had a little bit discussion in the chat on the genetic algorithms and the chance to get stuck in local minima. I had a question. I think it's important how that you have sufficient initialization points to be, but here you're not aiming at a global minimum, you're aiming at a satisfactory performance, isn't it? So that's probably as important.
Yeah, I think, but you also want, so in the end, the aim is to have the best fitted fall tree. And indeed, it could happen that you end up in a local minimum, but we have a very diverse set of rules by which we can change and that helps.
So you have a good walk, so to say. So it's less dependent upon the initialization then. Because there has been some literature on randomized approaches that's also in control theory, for example. If you do optimization in control systems, that's more my background where I was working in. Then you can show also by randomized approaches that there's a certain probability that you're close to the global optimum when you have sufficient points, so to say. So that's a way to get close, at least, or with sufficient probability to the global minimum. So probably that's here some kind of the same thing, but because you use different, you have different walk, so to say, by it's less dependent upon your initialization, it seems.
Mariella, do you have random mutations in your genetic algorithm?
Yeah, all mutations are random, yeah.
Yeah, but also random mutations that are not a combination of existing genes, so to say.
That we don't have. We
okay,
just
because that, that could that is often also used as an approach to basically augment your initial set.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm. No, there's lots to improve here. But for me, the main next step is to see this in practice, to see how useful it is, where real the which optimizations are really needed. I mean, is it useful at all?
I see.
That for me. And we can always have fun with a more sophisticated algorithm. Of course, we scientists like that.
Yeah, but you can also get lost in that. Huh? That yeah. It can be your lifetime work on that. And that's not your goal, I would say.
No end to it, really.
Yeah.
Not in this project. I also like, I have separate projects where I just try out theory just because I want to try things and maybe it turns out to be fully nonsense. And so maybe it turns out to be useful.
Yeah, but in this case, I think if you're a bit off the global minimum, but it's performing sufficiently well, you're from the application point of view, you're also satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
So then it makes probably no sense to put too much effort into finding the global minimum.
Yeah.
I mean, unless you really need the global to get satisfactory solutions, mm-hmm. right? But I mean,
the
solutions are fine.
Yeah, this is true. But I'm really curious if we can also learn other failure models, like the models Tito is working on or other people are working on. See if they make sense at all.
Okay. I guess we wrap it up here, right? So, Maria, thanks a lot for the very nice talk. Thanks, everybody, for the very nice discussions. Our peak was 65 attendees today, so that's very nice.
Okay.
So then.
And in 2 weeks.
Two weeks there will be the next talk. I just right now updating the web page. So the next talk is actually by Jan Braxma in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jan will. He is also an expert on FMEA, so one of the other models. So it's I think a good complement. I'm looking forward to his talk.
Okay.
Well, thanks a lot. Goodbye.
Goodbye and thanks.
And thanks a lot. Thanks, Mariella.
Yeah. Thank you, Stefan.
Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you. Goodbye.